Thank you, Rita. You're watching Southeast Today, our top story tonight. Increasing numbers of doctors under so much pressure, they're seeking mental health support.
The workforce is now broken, depleted, and is absolutely on the edge.
Three of our water companies have the dubious honour of being the most complained about in the UK. Seagulls fans cheer on Brighton and Hove Albion as their Europa match against Marseille gets underway. And she won't be back soon. Beverly Craven promises it's her last ever tour. She's here live with fellow performer Judy Zook. Hello, welcome to the programme. I'm Ellie Crissell. First tonight, the hundreds of Southeast doctors under so much pressure, they're having to access specialist mental health support, with increasing numbers of GPs suffering suicidal thoughts. Experts who run a confidential NHS programme say their caseload has risen sharply. Our health correspondent Mark Norman has this exclusive report.
Dr. David Triska was an army medic. He served two tours of Afghanistan. But it was the pressure of working as a GP in Surrey that led to a breakdown in his mental health.
A colleague told me, and I was conscious that things weren't right, and I needed to be told. And it took some time to recognise that that was what was happening. You know, I've had to take time off work, and I think as many of my colleagues have. And that was the only way to recuperate, which is extraordinary in a time when, you know, we're the people supposed to be providing care, and it's impossible within our own workplace and work system to provide that care for ourselves.
David is not alone. According to the General Medical Council, last year, more than 40% of doctors felt unable to cope with their workload. A quarter of doctors surveyed were categorised as being at high risk of burnout, while a little under half said they found it difficult to provide sufficient patient care at least once a week. All statistics that reinforce the message from the NHS Practitioners Service.
It's the intensity of the symptoms that people come to us with. There seems to be a lot more suicidal ideation in the people who are accessing the service. So for people who don't know what that means, it means that thoughts of suicide. And some people have made plans. So we recorded about a third of our patients having some sort of suicidal thought prior to registering with the service.
You can see where the artery was pinched. It's now nice and...
For some doctors, the problems can become too much. Dr. Jagdeep Sidhu was a successful consultant cardiologist at the peak of his career, but 5 years ago, he took his own life. His brother, realising the scale of the problem, set up a charity to help others.
I started the charity to try and raise awareness of issues of burnout within the medical profession specifically, because I found that my brother and many like him didn't have access to the right level of support. My older brother passed away in 2018, and I remember him saying just before he passed away, he felt the system was really buckling and stretched at that point. So here, as we, you know, talk about this today in 2023, it must be very, very hard to imagine, you know, 5 years on, how much harder it feels for everyone working in that system.
The Department of Health has told us that the well-being of all those working in the health service is vital, and extensive coaching, support and practitioner mental health services are available for all staff. There are more than 2,000 additional doctors and 31,000 additional staff in general practice, and they added they're doing more to create a sustainable NHS through the long-term workforce plan. But for Dr. David Triska, the problems are not easily solved.
Without inbuilt regulations that protect you, so, you know, whether that be with the number of people working, the type of work that you're doing, or the hours that you're working, if those aren't really regulated to any significant degree, then the risk of burnout is extremely high, and people do and will come to harm.
The Royal College of GPs says it feels deep moral distress that doctors can't deliver the timely care that patients rightly expect. But it also regards the NHS workforce plan as a possible solution to the immense pressures currently being felt by doctors across the health service.
Well, Mark is here now. Mark, this is a significant issue. Who heals the healers?
Yeah, it's the right question, isn't it? I mean, we need them to stay well. Let's take a look at the numbers of doctors seeking help and how that number's increased in just a couple of years. Now, you can see that in 2020, 2021, a little over 3,000 doctors were referred to this service. By this year, that number has risen to nearly 6,000. Interestingly, around 40% are GPs, the others largely hospital doctors, and one in seven are from the southeast. Now, one indication of the pressure GPs are under here locally is the patient to GP ratio. Just how many patients does each GP have on average on their list? Now, Kent and Medway has one of the highest figures, with each GP responsible for more than 2,200 patients. The numbers are slightly lower in Sussex and Surrey, but we can make a comparison with Merseyside and Liverpool, where there are just 1,500 patients on an average GP list. Add to this our growing ageing population, winter pressures, the struggle to attract and keep doctors in the health service, and the pressure on those doctors is not going to get any easier, Ellie.
Thank you very much for now, Mark. And details of organisations offering information and support with mental health are available at bbc.co.uk/actionline, or you can call this number for free to hear recorded information, 08000 155 998. Three of our water companies are topping lists for the most complained about in the UK, according to a new report from an industry watchdog. Southern, which provides water and wastewater services across Kent and Sussex, was the most complained about company, with their figure almost twice as high as the rate of complaints about Thames Water, which came second. Here's our environment correspondent, Yvette Austin.
Hastings Town Centre in January. The serious flood followed the most prolonged period of rainfall to hit the town for decades, and there's suspicion that the condition of southern water sewers contributed to the severity. But as yet, Hastings Council says nothing has been resolved.
Why did it happen? Why was it so bad? And what do we need to do to stop it happening again? We commissioned an independent report, and all the agencies agreed to provide all the evidence that was needed. Here we are 9 months later, and the report hasn't been published, and the reason, I'm told, is because Southern Water have been dragging their feet about providing evidence.
At nearby Bulverhithe, there have been burst sewer mains and reports too of suspected sewage leaking in a Hastings park and nature reserve. Many residents are deeply unhappy with Southern Water's response. Examples, perhaps, of why Southern has been named in a new report as the most complained about water company.
We've been contacting them on Twitter, by email. Some of us have done freedom of information requests, and they deny everything. They don't give any information.
The Consumer Council for Water isn't only criticising Southern, it's disappointed too with Thames Water, and South East Water is named as the worst performing company to provide water only. Outages over Christmas and in the early summer, along with a hosepipe ban, some explanation.
Customers can't switch supplier if they're unhappy. And this is why it's incumbent on all the water companies to really demonstrate to their customers that they empathise with the problem that they're having and are going to act efficiently and effectively to resolve that matter for them.
All the water companies say they're working hard to improve. Southern has embarked on a turnaround plan, a key area being its customer service. It says it's committed to significant improvements. Thames Water says it's already reduced household complaints by 28% compared to last year. And South East Water says millions of pounds is being spent on infrastructure. Back in Hastings, the council is considering legal action against Southern.
So we're so fed up with a succession of major incidents in Hastings over the last 2 years, and the fact that Southern Water hasn't resolved any of them. And we've said if they don't resolve these incidents by the end of this year, we'll start to think seriously about what action we can take after Christmas, including legal action.
On a positive note, I'm told a sewage leak here in Bulverhithe last week has now been fixed. Yvette Austin, BBC South East Today, Hastings.
The father of an 18-month-old boy allegedly murdered by his mother and her former boyfriend has today told Maidstone Crown Court that his son was as good as gold. Alfie Phillips sustained 70 separate injuries when he died in 2020 near Faversham. His father, Sam Phillips, said he was always just Alfie, always laughing, always playing. Jack Benham and Sean Hedges both deny murder and their trial continues. Closing libraries and poorer quality roads are both signs that Kent County Council is struggling financially. That's according to its cabinet member for finance, as the authority aims to make £86 million of savings in the next financial year. Peter Oakford was speaking as the council met today to discuss a financial recovery plan.
We're asking the residents to pay more for a smaller service. That is the reality of local government at the moment. It's very, very challenging. We're doing everything we can to maintain the key services, to maintain the services that value most to our residents.
Gillingham Football Club have sacked their manager. Neil Harris has spent a year and a half in charge. He leaves with the Gills in eighth place in League Two, 4 points behind leaders Notts County. Keith Millen is now in temporary charge. Sir Keir Starmer says he's searching for a better solution to the problem of air pollution in the South East as he refuses to give his support to the expansion of London's ultra-low emission zone introduced by the city's Labour mayor. This week, the first fines have been issued to drivers of non-compliant vehicles who enter the zone and fail to pay that daily charge. Well, our political editor Charlotte Wright has spoken to the Labour leader ahead of their party conference and started by asking if expanding ULEZ was the right thing to do.
Well, look, I've always said that we do need to take measures to ensure that we've got clean air. I've got two children, one aged 15, one aged 12. I don't give them dirty water and I don't want them to breathe in dirty air. And I think I speak for pretty well everyone in saying that. I do think, though, that the schemes we introduce need to be proportionate and not impact on those that are going to struggle most to pay for them.
So was the expansion of the ULEZ scheme in London proportionate?
Well, look, that was a decision for the mayor. He's under a legal obligation to do something. But what I want to look at is wider schemes, alternatives, so that we don't disproportionately impact people often struggling in relation to their day-to-day finances, paying the bills, etc.
You've mentioned the people struggling. We've spoken to businesses who fear going under. We've spoken to families who can't afford to go to their local supermarket anymore. People in Kent and Surrey who live just 100 metres from the expanded zone who don't get any scrappage support. Is that right?
Well, I think the mayor has called on the government to extend the scrappage outside of London. The government
would you have
hasn't
done that
done
if
that.
You were in government?
But I think the government needs to look at that. Obviously,
but
we
would
will
Labour
set out.
Have paid
but we'll set out in full what our plans are as we go into the election. I do think there are other ways of ensuring we've got clean air in the first place, because other cities are doing it in a slightly different way.
It doesn't sound like the London ULEZ scheme has got your full support. Do you wish the mayor hadn't expanded it?
Well, look, the mayor was in a difficult position because he's under a legal obligation to take measures to mitigate against air pollution.
I think people watching this at home in the southeast won't be clear on what your position is on the ULEZ scheme in London at the moment, and they want to know because they may well vote for you at the next election next year. So can you say now whether or not the expansion of the ULEZ scheme as it is in London has your full support?
I want to look at all the options, and I want to look at...
So is that a no?
I want to look at all the options. I want to see what other ways are available to ensure that we have clean air. But what I'm not going to back off from is the idea that we should have clean air. But are there other ways of dealing with this? I think there are, and that's what we would work constructively on to make sure and to say and to ensure anybody who's listening and watching this that we are on your side. We know that you are struggling, and we will therefore strive to come up with schemes that achieve the objective of cleaner air but don't disproportionately impact on the day-to-day finances that I know people are struggling with. I absolutely understand.
So does that mean other ULEZ schemes elsewhere in the South East if Labour in power?
Look, I think there are different ways of achieving the same thing.
How different to what we've got in London?
Well, other places are doing it differently with the work they're doing on their buses, the work they're doing around the cities in other ways. So we shouldn't just make this a divide point. We should, I think, get round the table and say, look, let's find a better solution to the problem that is, you know, polluted air that we do not want our children to be breathing.
Okay, so Keir Starmer, thank you.
Thank you.
Well, Charlotte joins us live from Westminster now. Charlotte, he wouldn't quite answer the question that you were pressing him on, would he? But it certainly didn't sound like he was endorsing the ULEZ expansion.
No, and I think this might be the most critical we've heard him on the topic. Of course, this is a really tricky topic for Labour. On the one hand, ULEZ has been expanded by a Labour London mayor. But on the other hand, many think that it's the reason that they didn't win the by-election in Boris Johnson's old seat in Uxbridge back in the summer. And so clearly Sir Keir Starmer, on the one hand, is trying to not criticise his Labour colleague at the same time as not endorse a policy that many see as very controversial. Now, Sadiq Khan says the reason for expanding the scheme is because he needs to clean up the air and he needs to take decisive action to do that. But clearly Sir Keir is saying that he wants to look at other options. I think the question that lots of people at home will be thinking right now and before the next election next year is exactly what is he going to do instead?
Charlotte, thank you very much. And our series of interviews with the main party leaders continues tomorrow when we speak to Carla Denyer, the co-leader of the Green Party. Now, it is just after a quarter to seven. This is our top story tonight. Hundreds of Southeast doctors are under so much pressure they're having to access specialist mental health support, with increasing numbers suffering suicidal thoughts. Also in tonight's programme, we'll have the very latest from Marseille as Brighton and Hove Albion's first Europa away game is well underway.
And you'd be forgiven for thinking it's a summer forecast. It's unseasonably warm. Will it last? I'll have the details later in the programme.
Now, Beverley Craven became a household name in 1990 with her song Promise Me. And after 40 years in the music business, she's announced a final live tour, which comes to the Gulbenkian in Canterbury next month. It's called Strings Attached, and we'll see her perform alongside fellow singer-songwriter Judy Zook. We'll speak to them live in just a moment, but first, let's see some of their hits. Promise me. A beautiful sound. Well, Beverley and Judy are here now. Thank you so much for coming in to talk to us. It's lovely to meet you both. So are you excited about going out? Is this the final tour? Is it like Elton John, like the final tour?
No, it's for me. Sorry, that's my microphone. So for me, it's the final tour. It's not for you.
I don't think it is for me.
You're going to keep going. Good for you. Perhaps we can persuade you as well to come out of retirement.
Do you know, having sort of said to everyone, you know, my agent and the PR guy and everyone, that I'm retiring, I've already I feel like it's really strange coming into the TV studio today.
Do you feel like you've taken a step
already
back?
Yes, I feel it's a bit strange, and I think I've got to do some shows.
I know.
But you've had such a long, fulfilling career.
Yeah.
Did you both think that you would still be on tour all these years later?
I didn't. But I've always just done it. It's, for me, my music's almost like something I was always going to do, whether I actually ever had any success or not. So I've just kept going, and I'll probably go until I stop, really. I can't stop sort of writing songs and making music. It's what I love.
She's a proper writer.
Oh, I think you're both proper writers. That last clip was from the Woman to Woman tour.
Yes.
That was your last tour.
That was with Jules, yeah, Jules Fordham.
Yeah, what was that like? Was it fun going on tour, the three of you together?
It was incredibly hard work, wasn't it?
It was hard work, but it was fantastic on stage. And it was, for me, watching the audience made me realise quite how much your song, you know, with Promise Me and my song and Julia's songs, really affected people at a certain time in their life. So
it was such a nostalgic show, wasn't it? A wonderful tour, really. It definitely was.
And we didn't know it was going to be quite like that. We didn't really know that we were all going to be singing together in the beginning. I think it was when we arranged to do it. I always had visions
of you and Jules doing my backing vocals, yeah, and then me and Jules doing yours, and then so you know that all made sense. So we'd all be singing all the time.
Yes. Well, that's great.
Onto our tour that we're doing.
Oh yeah.
Yes. you said to me when we chatted before, it's a nice gentle tour.
Oh, it is.
What does that mean?
Well, it's semi-classical, isn't it?
Yes.
This strings tour. We've got a lovely string quartet, all girls, and then Jude's got a guitarist, yes, Chaz. And
he loves being with all the girls.
Yeah. I play the piano, so it's sort of semi-acoustic and classical.
It sounds like a beautiful evening of music, just kind of washing over you in a really lovely way.
I think your songs really lend themselves to strings arrangements, yes, as well as mine, you know, so... Works great.
But will you be doing your big hit? You've given us all an earworm in the newsroom today, Beverly. We've all been singing.
There's nothing more annoying.
Once it goes in, you can't get a minute.
I'm so sorry. It's one of the perils.
A classic
of the music business.
Will you be performing it?
Of course. Yes.
Yes.
Of course. Yeah. Yes. Definitely. I think we're both quite lucky that it's not the worst song we ever wrote. I mean, like, I do know people who've had big hits and it's their least favourite song. And
so
they
you
hate
don't hate it because
do
you've
it.
Done
no,
it
No, I still love it and I think you do too.
No, it's really nice, especially when everyone sings along.
Oh, so. Yes, it's going to be magical. Thank you so much for joining us today. Best
Thank
of luck
you very
in the
much.
Tour.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now, to football now. Action is underway at the Stade Velodrome with Brighton and Hove Albion currently, oh dear, 2 goals down against Marseille in their first ever European away fixture. They are facing a team which remains the only French side to win the Champions League. They've won 9 league titles and their 67,000 capacity ground makes it the largest club stadium in France. Piers Hopkirk is there live for us this evening. Hello, Piers. Not going too well inside the stadium at the moment, but still a real historic moment for fans.
Yes, we may not be inside the stadium, but you can tell the score by the noise alone. But it has still been a remarkable day for Brighton fans, a day of pride, a day of passion, as the Seagulls faced their continental baptism.
He loves to serve me, a Sussex boy to see. His name is Ansu, Ansu Fati.
Marseille's Place de la Joliette, a Mediterranean square today transformed into a slice of Sussex by the sea. Amid the cheers and the beers, it's above all a day of passion and pride.
I've been supporting them since I was 10, and it's like all through the years of the disappointment of nearly dropping out the Football League, Hereford, the upset, the goal that got us back in it. Oh my God, by Ronnie Ryder. It's just amazing to be here. Whatever the outcome, it's just togetherness and excitement.
It's incredible. I've been a Brighton fan since 1985. Started at the Goldstone, then did my time at Gillingham and with Dean, and dragged this little fella with me from the with Dean days now at Falmer. Moment in history, this, it's incredible.
This is a dream come true. I've supported Albion since I was 11. I was there at the last game at the Goldstone, and to bring my son on our first ever European away game is incredible.
How proud are you as a Seagulls fan to be here?
Very, very proud.
It's been an emotional journey, and for some, a challenging one, as they travelled the 800 miles from Sussex to the Côte d'Azur.
I finished my night shift at 5, straight to Gatwick to Geneva, about 1 o'clock. We've got the train down to Lyon, and then an hour in Lyon, back down here. We got to the hotel about 7.
How are you feeling now, though?
Well rested, slept well last night, I can tell you.
Some of the surrounding shops were drunk dry as Albion fans soaked up more than just the atmosphere. Then it was onto the buses, bound for the stadium. And for a flavour of the fanaticism that awaits them, this Marseille merchandise store lays out the shirts of its French football rivals, so you can wipe your feet on them on the way in. And standing outside, it's easy to see how they turn their stadium into a fortress.
Well, Brighton are now mixing it with some of the giants of Europe, and this is just the kind of reception they can expect.
This is something special, it seems like in Argentina, in South America. And Marseille is very special in France for the amazing fan.
For fans of either side, a day that surely few will forget.
Well, we've met a lot of pretty delirious fans today, but spare a thought for those Seagulls supporters who are on the flight from Heathrow. It was delayed for 3 hours. They faced missing the match completely, but fortunately, Chairman Tony Bloom was on board. He arranged for coaches to come straight to the airport to pick them up and bring them to the stadium. And I understand they've made it in time for the second half.
Excellent, Piers. Thank you very much. And a reminder that you can listen to that second half, a live commentary on BBC Radio Sussex. Time now for a look at the weather. Rachel Mackley is here with me in the studio. Hello.
Hello.
So we've got a touch of Marseille in the forecast.
Oh, no, lots of sunshine. It is going to be really warm over the next couple of days. You will be forgiven to thinking this is a summer forecast. There's a bit more cloud first thing, but of course, by the afternoon, lots of sunshine around. So clear blue skies as we head through the next couple of days. And indeed, this is actually a different picture. It's not going to be that many brooding skies around over the next couple of days. This is Jamie McBeam, and he has won the Young Photographer of the Year for this dramatic photograph of Herne Bay. So don't worry, there's no brooding clouds in the forecast for us over the next couple of days. It's a much calmer picture. We've got lots of sunshine around and it's unseasonably warm. So temperatures by Saturday will be reaching highs around 25 degrees. Average for the time of year is just 16. So really warm as we head through the next couple of days. Through the rest of this evening, clearer skies around. There were one or two scattered showers very earlier this morning, but through the rest of the day we've been dry, and we hold on to that dry weather through tonight as well. It's a mild picture. Overnight temperatures staying in double figures, only dropping there to around 11 or 12 degrees. So it's going to be a mild start to the day for Friday. It's bright and breezy, but those winds now back from a westerly to a southwesterly direction. So we're going to be dragging up some very warmer air from the near continent. So by the afternoon, just look at these temperatures nudging up to the low 20s. Highs there around 21 or 22 degrees. More of the same as we look towards the weekend. It's a mild night over into Saturday. And by Saturday afternoon, potentially seeing highs of around 25, maybe even 26 degrees. It was a little bit cooler along the coast, but even there, highs of around 21. So the reason for that, we've got high pressure around. We're dragging up this very warm air just over Spain. Temperatures around 33 degrees. And for us, of course, over the next couple of days, we're holding on to that warmth. So lots of sunshine in the forecast during the afternoon on Saturday, potentially reaching highs around 24 or 25 degrees. A touch cooler for Sunday, but still lots of sunshine into the new week. Enjoy.
25 degrees in October. That's got to be some kind of record. Thank you, Rachel. That is almost it from me. Just a bit of good news before I go. Brighton have pulled one back. The score currently in Marseille, 2-1. I'm back at 10:30. Bye-bye.